Penguin Random House Audio presents Leadership is Language, the Hidden Power of What You Say and What You Don't. This is the author, L. David Marquet. This book is dedicated to the crew of El Faro, with the belief that their example will invite self-reflection upon our own language and the hope that they will help us become better leaders.
Foreword by Shane Mack. Read by Jack Armstrong. Let me save you some time and heartbreak. Listen to what David says. I only wish I did sooner. It would have saved me a lot of grief and millions of dollars. Like many people you know, or maybe even you, I've spent my life trying to make it look like I had all the answers. I needed everyone to think I was smart. Whatever the cause, I was raised to believe being right and having the answers was a hallmark of leadership. It wasn't until my last company that I realized something was wrong. After raising over $30 million, recruiting some of the best people I've ever worked with, and having the opportunity to lead and build product at one of the hottest startups in Silicon Valley, I couldn't escape a gnawing, enigmatic dread. We had enough capital. We had the right people, and yet everyone was miserable. It took me a long time to see and admit it, but I was the problem. When I didn't know the answers, I felt insecure, and I did not want people to see it. So I overcompensated by pushing. I cajoled people to get on board, go my way or get out. I had convinced myself that this was the right approach because, of course, I had the answers. Everyone left. The company was recapitalized, and all the investors lost their money. No one else got a dollar, and I was depressed. A few years before these events, I saw David Marquet speak. Everything he said was the opposite of the approach I later adopted at that failed business. In moments of clarity during those times, I would remember David's words and wish I could find a way to apply them to our work. The chastening experience of that failure caused me to recommit to developing my leadership skills. At my next company, Assist, I rebuilt my approach from the ground up, with David's guidance as my foundation. With my co-founder, Robert Stevens, the founder of Geek Squad, Assist became the leader in the AI space, powering brands on new platforms like Google Assistant, Alexa, and messaging apps. There is zero question that David's insight and guidance contributed in a giant way to our success. From the first word I wrote to start the company, everything was through the lens of what this book is about. Curiosity was our core value. We celebrated what we didn't know, and know-it-alls weren't welcome. How we used our words became how we respected people and operated effectively. We practiced using language with one another that forced people to own making decisions. We would remind people it's okay to say, "I don't know." I hired people and asked them to teach me. We helped people go from saying, "I think we should," to, "I've already done." There was no need to ask for permission. Today, my number one priority is partnering to create a workplace culture that expands the range of empowerment so more people have the skills and agency to act in the service of the greatest good. Inversely, the more permission that is needed, the less people will be empowered to think and lead, and the worse the place will be to work. It wasn't always easy. Many people don't believe they can or should operate in this way. Ultimately, I saw my job as CEO evolve to a place where my goal was to make as few decisions as possible. That's a long distance away from the guy who had to hide behind a mask of all knowledge. Everything in this book is exactly how I strive to lead Assist. And in 2019, Assist was acquired for millions. As I watched my colleagues move to great positions at prestigious companies, I felt incredibly lucky to have had the opportunity to learn and grow alongside some of the best leaders I've ever worked with. David's not promising an easier, shorter path, but in my experience, It's one that leaves everyone feeling whole, empowered, and eager to dive back in the next day. That works for me. Shane Mack, Nashville, June 2019.
Introduction. I used to think I was special. It started in high school when I earned better grades than almost everyone around me. This trend continued into my time at the U.S. Naval Academy. Truth was, I was just a prescient and skilled test taker. But after graduating and rising to the rank of captain in the Navy's submarine force, I mistakenly concluded that I'd risen so quickly because I was more observant, disciplined, committed, thoughtful, and caring than the people around me. It's hard to admit, but at the time, I felt pretty sure I was better at getting stuff done, and just plain better, than the people I worked with. Secure in my sense of superiority, I became the first one to spot problems and the first one to see solutions to those problems, too. I told people what they should do, and through rank, influence, and sheer rhetorical force, coerced them into complying with my instructions. In my haste to get stuff done, I left no time for others to make their own contributions. My division or department was an assembly line, one that cranked out actions instead of cars or lawnmowers. I was the foreman of the action factory because I knew better than everyone else. There were plenty of signs that my view was distorted, had I been willing to see them. People would hesitatingly offer a good idea every now and then. Occasionally, they would take smart, decisive action without my direction. Once in a while, I would make a mistake, directing my team in a way that wasn't optimal or was just plain wrong. In these scenarios, my subordinates would comply with bad orders, despite all my lectures to speak up if they ever saw a problem. Afterward, when things went off the rails, they would shrug and say they were just doing what they'd been told. In response, I would double down on giving clear, concise, and correct orders. I spent 28 years being evaluated and ranked. The Navy is highly competitive. Top spots are scarce. In this environment of continuous judgment and evaluation, I experienced constant pressure to prove myself. Every exam, every monthly report, every inspection, every meeting, every day was another trial, another opportunity to prove and perform. A single bad outcome might affect a promotion, a pay raise, my social standing, even my sense of self-worth. As I regarded my achievements with pride, I chafed at the sense that others didn't give me adequate recognition for my contributions. I adopted a closed, invulnerable persona, firmly rooted in a performance mindset. If life was going to be a rat race, you can bet your whiskers I was going to win it, however hard I had to drive my people to do so. Operating this way, conforming to hierarchical roles, maintaining emotional distance from others, avoiding vulnerability at all costs, is lonely and unfulfilling. Although I was proud of my promotions and awards, something profoundly important was missing. Turning the ship around. My journey took an unexpected detour when the captain of the nuclear-powered submarine USS Santa Fe abruptly quit, and I was suddenly put in command. Santa Fe was the laughingstock of the fleet. At the time, I joked that she only had two problems, the fleet's worst morale and its worst performance to boot. Each month, the Navy would publish the 12-month reenlistment and retention rate for all 50 or so submarines, and inevitably, Santa Fe would be at the bottom of the list. Not near the bottom, all the way at the bottom by a good margin, with 90% of Santa Fe's crew getting out of the Navy at the end of their time on board. That was the morale problem I had to solve. The other problem was bad performance. Santa Fe was getting poor inspection scores across all her operations, from food service to firing torpedoes, from navigation to the nuclear power plant. She also had higher than average safety incidents. Normally, my prove-and-perform leadership approach would have been just what the doctor ordered, if I had known the ship. But as it turned out, I had spent 12 months preparing to take over a different submarine. I was driving blind. When I came aboard my new submarine, I started asking questions. In the past, I'd always made a practice of asking questions, but they were more like test questions. I already knew the answers, did they? Now, I was asking questions because I needed to know how the ship worked. This meant I had to admit to my crew that for many of the details, I did not know the answers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.